Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, and welcome to this service of worship. This evening at 5 p.m., our organ recital series will continue with Dr. Thomas Murray, professor of music and university organist at Yale Music School. All are welcome, and you can find more information in your bulletin. Next Sunday, February 5th, worshipers are invited to gather in the West Union for lunch following the service. If you'd like to join, you can purchase lunch, and then members of the fellowship committee at the congregation will be on hand to direct you within West Union. It's a big place. We do hope that you'll join us for this time of food and fellowship next week. Finally, on Tuesday of next week, Dr. Dia Abdo, chair of the English and Creative Writing Department at Guilford College, will speak here at Duke Chapel on Every Campus a Refuge, an initiative which calls on colleges and universities around the world to assist in resettlement by hosting one refugee family on campus. Dr. Abdo will speak on this timely and important subject here on Tuesday, February 7th at 6 p.m. And again, you can find more information in your bulletin. Lord, may your care and mercy lead us to a just society. With the Spirit's gifts, empower us for the work of ministry. Please stand and join our opening hymn.
Lord has given us a great commission, sending us into the world to love and serve others. Our response to God's commission is often weak and fearful. Trusting divine mercy and the promise that God is with us, let us confess our sins. Let us pray. O God of truth and justice, there are times it feels foolish to try to confront the injustices of our world, so we do nothing. Lord, have mercy. Lord of steadfast love, in a world of harsh and competing demands, it may seem fruitless to strive to live with gentleness and kindness, so we don't. Christ, have mercy. Almighty God, ruler of all, in a culture that values independence and achievement, humility, even in relationship to you, seems unwise, so we rely on our own wisdom. Lord, have mercy. Knowing that you know us better than we know ourselves, we seek your mercy and pray that you would restore us to the joy of your salvation. In our Savior's name we pray. Amen. According to the prophet Micah, the Lord declares, I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery. In the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are freed from the slavery to sin and death once and for all. Friends, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. As God's forgiven people, let us now turn to one another to share the peace of Christ.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. Heavenly Father, you send the gospel to the ends of the earth and your messengers to every nation. Send your Holy Spirit to transform us and to illuminate your holy word. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Micah, the 6th chapter. Hear what the Lord says. Rise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Hear, you mountains, the controversy of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a controversy with his people, and he will contend with Israel. O my people, what have I done to you? In what have I wearied you? Answer me. For I brought you up from the land of Egypt and redeemed you from the house of slavery. And I sent before you Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. O my people, remember now what King Balak of Moab devised, what Balaam, son of Beor, answered him, and what happened from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the saving acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. This is the word of the Lord. The New Testament lesson is from 1 Corinthians, the first chapter. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. And the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom. God decided, through the foolishness of our proclamation, to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim that Christ is crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. He is the source of your life in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God, and righteousness, and sanctification, and redemption, in order that, as it is written, let the one who boasts, boast in the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
The lesson is from Matthew, the 5th chapter. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This is the word of the Lord.
Please be seated. Let us pray. Let the water of your word wash over us. Help us to be like Jesus. We want to be Christians, O God, in our hearts and in our words and deeds. So seal this word on our hearts, that we might be more like you. In Christ's name, amen. Consider your own call, brothers and sisters. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth, but God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are, so that no one might boast in the presence of God. Who and what God chooses is so interesting. Not many in the Corinthian church were powerful civic leaders in Washington, D.C. Not many were Hollywood celebrities. Not many were the rich and famous of Beverly Hills, nor the well-educated of Harvard. There were some known, like Crispus and Gaius and Stephanus, but not many. Most were unnamed and unfamed and unnoticeable. No PhD, no MD, only perhaps a GED, maybe. This was the early church. This is the church, supposedly, consisting of primarily the weak, the lowly, and despised in the world. Paul must be playing a big joke on us this morning, because none of us here would apply for a job boasting that we are weak and despised. This wouldn't be on our tongues at such an elite university as Duke. Rather, we might claim that we are the best of the best. We are the influencers and movers and shakers in the world, the top thought leaders, the sophisticated Christian intelligentsia shaping the discourse in our various fields. But the church is, or at least should be, different. There may be some wise by human standards, some powerful, and some of noble birth, but not many. The vast majority consists of the underwhelming, the underside, and the underappreciated of society. Where are they this morning? This isn't my ecclesiology, my understanding of the church. This is God's choosing, God's church. God chose what is foolish. God chose what is weak. God chose what is low. God chooses the despised, the ostracized, and the demonized. It should be of no surprise, then, that later in this letter to the Corinthian church, we hear Paul admonish them to never say to any part of the body, "I have no need of you." Because in Christ's body, everybody is somebody. There are no nobodies in Christ's body. On the contrary, Paul says the members of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And those members of the body that we think less honorable, we clothe with greater honor. And our less respectable members are treated with greater respect, whereas our more respectable members do not need this. But God has arranged the body, giving the greater honor to the inferior member. The inferior and weaker ones. God chooses to honor them and welcome them into the community, for any church will be known by how they treat the most vulnerable in their midst. God chooses and uses the foolish, the weak, the low and despised to reveal his heart. A heart that is revealed throughout Scripture for refugees, for strangers and immigrants, widows, orphans, the hungry, the thirsty, the naked, the sick, and the prisoner. God chooses the despised and denigrated to be a part of Christ's body. These are the many in Christ's church. Even in Christ's inaugural sermon, his ministry focuses on the poor, the captive, the blind, the oppressed, the scorned and scorched of the world. God chooses marginal figures as members of Christ's one body. Those who are despised are destined to make their home with God, because God chooses to make room for them in the body. Now, the wisdom of the world may think differently, but in the wisdom of God, this is the way to unity in the Spirit. The words of the sonnet, the new Colossus, are inscribed on a plaque on the inner wall of the pedestal of the Statue of Liberty. That poem calls the mighty woman with a torch, the Statue of Liberty, the mother of exiles, and says that from her beacon hand glows worldwide welcome. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free, the wretched refuse of your teeming shore. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. I lift my lamp beside the golden door. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, the wretched refuse, and makes Christ church. Notice that God doesn't build walls, but in Christ has broken down the dividing wall of hostility between people and creates one new humanity, one body in Christ, making peace. The church is a mixed class community, some named, but many unnamed. It doesn't mean there aren't struggles across social strata like we see at the Lord's Supper in the Corinthian church, where one goes hungry and another becomes drunk, revealing tensions between the haves and the have-nots. Yet God chooses to construct a big tent to hold diversity within the church together to work for the unity of the Spirit. Rich and poor, male and female, the powerful and the weak. Politically, this may all seem foolish, but theologically, it is the wisdom of God, a foolish wisdom. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. God chooses what is foolish in the world. And the word Paul uses for foolishness is from where we get the English word moron. So one might say that God acts in moronic ways and chooses fools, morons, to do the ministry of Christ in the world. If we take a look at some of the Old Testament prophets, we may learn that God has been working in mysterious ways through fools for centuries. The prophet Isaiah walked naked and barefoot for about 3 years, predicting the future captivity in Egypt. The prophet Ezekiel lay before a stone which symbolized struggling Jerusalem, and though God instructed him to eat bread baked on human waste, he asked ultimately to use cow dung instead. And prophet Hosea married a harlot to symbolize the infidelity of Israel before God. These are not your typical upstanding church members, but they represent the unorthodox, foolish wisdom of God, the morons in God's ministry. God apparently had gone mad by the looks of it. And in early Christianity, there was a parody of the method of God's madness and foolishness. The image was called the Alexamenos graffito, or graffito blasphemo. It was carved in the plaster of a wall near the Palatine Hill in Rome. It shows a Christian boy, Alexamenos, being mocked by another boy or by a group of his school peers. The parody shows a man with a donkey's head being crucified on a Tau cross. In front of the cross stands this young man, presumably Alexamenos, raising his hand as if in prayer. At the top of the picture are the words, "Alexamenos worships his God." His God is in the form of a man with a donkey's head hanging on a cross. In antiquity, though it was applauded for being hardworking, the donkey was also mocked for being plain stupid. And eventually, the donkey became the regular metaphor for stupidity and foolishness. In Christianity, there was the tradition claiming that Joseph and Mary fled with the child to Egypt on a donkey, although this specific detail is not in the Bible. The donkey was venerated for many generations as a vehicle for salvation. Even in the triumphal entry to Jerusalem, Jesus rode on the back of a donkey, fulfilling the prophecy of Zechariah, carrying overtones of foolishness and representing Christ's carnivalesque parody of worldly power and authority. The donkey has always been a part of the foolish history of God. So the message of a crucified Christ and its foolishness is captured in this carved image of a crucified donkey God. It was laughable, foolish, and absurd. This was the folly of the cross caught in an unforgettable image, merging the crucified Christ with a donkey. Not many of you were wise by human standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chooses dumb donkeys. Just as God used Balaam's ass, God still uses the same creatures today in the form of human beings. But as that ancient plaster depiction shows, donkeys, the fools of God, the moron ministers, end up hanging out to dry and die on a cross. Because fools get ridiculed, but they also get crucified. Yet God chooses donkeys, chooses the weak, chooses the low and despised, chooses the word of the cross to be the power of God. A cross was a symbol of failure and public embarrassment, as it was a tool, an ancient form of death row, used to enforce the Pax Romana, Roman imperial peace. Revolutionaries, terrorists, criminals, slaves were punished on it and made laughing stocks of society. To be put on a cross meant ugliness, contempt, weakness, loser, unpatriotic scumbag. It was where donkeys belonged. But God chooses the cross and lands on it, becoming a crucified Christ, the means of salvation and the revelation of the power of God. A crucified Christ was an oxymoron. God is a moron, is foolish, has gone mad, is so mad, madly in love with the world for which Christ died. It makes no worldly sense. But that's the method of God's madness, a grotesque death to bring us the glory of God and life everlasting. And through the foolishness of the proclamation of Christ crucified, save the world. A crucified donkey God is the means of salvation. God does things on God's own terms, so we would boast in God and find our source of life in Christ Jesus. All of our credentials are crucified with the donkey. And we find ourselves by losing ourselves in the foolish wisdom of God and the foolishness of the cross. We discover life at and on the cross with the foolish, with the weak, with the low and despised, the donkeys of today's world, the outcast, the victims, the huddled masses, the wretched refuse, the migrants who have nowhere to lay their heads, the Christ. The cross of Christ reminds us and tells the truth, not alternative facts, that not many of us are wise by human standards. Not many of us are powerful, not many of us are of noble birth, but many of us are morons in the ministry of Jesus. We are fools in Christ's body, donkeys on a mission. And as such, and as argued in a recent essay by Stanley Hauerwas, Christians don't believe in ourselves or country. We believe in God and worship God, a God whose work confounds the wisdom of the world. And as worshipers of this God who displays radical, foolish love on a cross, we too are followers of this chief fool in heaven. When we pray in the Lord's Prayer on earth as it is in heaven, this is a call to bring this divine foolishness to earth and to be mad with the love of God, so mad that you become a fool of the faith, a moron for Jesus in the Spirit. Just as God was so foolish to choose us, we're called to choose the weak and choose the low and despised, to choose to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with our God, to choose to speak the truth from our hearts, to choose to be a fool for unconditional love and mercy, to choose hope. Be that donkey that carries the light of the crucified, risen Christ into the streets. Bring the madness, because God is mad, a fool, a mighty moron, making the world right. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart. In other words, Lord, I want to be a moron for you. Where are the donkeys? I know there is one on the cross, and I hope we have some here too.
Let us stand to affirm our faith using the ancient words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. God of wisdom, we praise you that your ways are not our ways, and that in Jesus Christ you have revealed yourself to us. In Christ and through Christ, you have turned our understandings upside down, showing us what is foolish and what is wise. Continue to upend our thinking and our beliefs as you draw us closer to yourself. Open us to the strange ways you work in our world, moving us to commit ourselves to your purposes. And when we are foolish, reveal your wisdom, that we may discern your calling for each of us. Oh God, for those of us here in an academic community where we value intellect, knowledge, and scholarship, remind us that all truth comes from you and that your wisdom will always be greater than what we can fathom. Lord, in your mercy. God of all peoples and nations, we come before you praying for our world. Irrational loyalties have led to conflict. Ill-advised priorities have fostered struggle. Unreasonable goals have created battles. All of this has grown into wars and violence and spread throughout the world. So we long for your peace in Syria, Somalia, and all other countries of the world. Give wisdom to world leaders that they may work for the good of all and protect the innocent caught in the midst of violence. We pray for peace on our city streets, in Chicago, in Durham, in every community. Guide neighbors to care for one another, to reject turf battles, and to work for solutions that benefit the whole. By your Spirit, bring our foolish violence to an end. We pray for those who long for a nation in which they can build their lives. Give strength to those who flee violence, and hope to those who are looking for a home. Help us to welcome those in our midst. Lord, in your mercy. O God of comfort and new life, we each know individuals who need your tender mercies. For those who are recuperating from surgery, restore them and grant them patience in the healing process. For those who are physically ill and determining treatment, ease their anxiety and direct them into paths of wholeness. For those who are burdened by mental illness, enable them to know they are not alone and grant them your hope. For those who are dying and those who are grieving, grant your unending presence and peace. Lord, in your mercy. With gratitude that you have invited us to come to you in prayer, we offer all these prayers in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. All of today's cash offerings and undesignated gifts will go to underwrite the chapel's Spring Break Mission Program. This year, two groups are heading out in March, one group to visit Costa Rica and another the Holy Cross Abbey in Virginia. Out of gratitude to God, let us offer our gifts and our lives.
Let us pray. Lord God, your breath gives us life, sustains our spirit, and strengthens us to follow your ways. We thank you for welcoming us into your family, empowering us to follow in the way of your cross, and enabling us to testify to your resurrected life. We offer again ourselves to you, all that we are, all that we have, and all that we desire. Use the gifts gathered today to be a blessing to students and to your church throughout the world. Fill the work of Costa Rica Missions Project and Holy Cross Abbey with your grace, that they might be faithful witnesses to you, and grant us faith to be people of your kingdom today and every day. We offer you our prayers and praise in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Blessed are you who strive to follow the way of Jesus. Blessed are you who seek to know the foolishness of the cross. Blessed are you who welcome the stranger in the name of the Lord. May the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with us this day and always. Amen.